Hi everyone, welcome to the new course on chemistry, that is surface chemistry. Surface chemistry, it is the branch of chemistry which deals with the studies of surface phenomena. Usually this is one of the simplest chapter and you are going to get at least one question from this chapter. So before going to the multiple choice questions which most probably asked on surface chemistry, first we will see what are the concepts that we have learnt in this chapter. Okay, so first concept that we have learnt in surface chemistry is adsorption. Adsorption, it is a surface phenomena, and in this adsorption we can find two different types of adsorption. One is reversible and another one is irreversible adsorption. So when we say the adsorption is reversible and when we say the adsorption is irreversible, the adsorption is said to be reversible if the adsorbent can be easily removed from the surface of the adsorbent by physical methods. So by using physical methods, if we remove the adsorbent, then it is said to be adsorption. And if the adsorbent cannot be removed from the surface of the adsorbent, then that adsorption is known as irreversible adsorption. So these are the two types based on how we can remove the adsorbent surface of the adsorbed substances from the surface of the adsorbent. And there are different types of examples can be given for reversible adsorption as well as for irreversible adsorption. Next, adsorbent and adsorbate and interface. So these are the three terms that we usually used for explaining the adsorption process. The substances upon whose surface the change of concentration occurs is called adsorbent. Okay, means adsorbent is the surface where the adsorption process will take place, that is simply called as adsorbent. And the molecules or the substances which gets adsorbed on the surface are known as adsorbates. And the surface in which adsorption process will take place is said to be interface. Means it acts as a bridge between two phases. Okay, so between two phases, the surface is present and that surface is said to be interface. Okay, these are some common terms that we use. Then types of adsorption. There are two types of adsorption, physisorption and chemisorption. First we will see what are the characteristics of physisorption and chemisorption and the difference between those physisorption and chemisorption. So in physisorption, only van der Waals force are present between adsorbate and adsorbent. Okay, so van der Waals forces means London force, okay, as well as you can say dipole-dipole forces, hydrogen bond, all these are weak van der Waals forces that are present between adsorbate and surface of adsorbent. And in case of chemisorption, the chemical bonds are formed between adsorbate and surface of the adsorbent. In the physisorption, it has low enthalpy of adsorption. Okay, since the weak van der Waals forces are there, so low amount of heat energy is released or absorbed during the adsorption process. And you know, adsorption is exothermic process. So usually heat is released during the process, and that heat amount released during the process will be very low for physisorption. And for chemisorption, high enthalpy of adsorption will be observed. Okay, and physisorption is reversible and chemisorption is irreversible. That you already learned what is, when we say the adsorption is reversible and when we say the adsorption is irreversible. It usually takes place at low temperature and does not require activation energy. Okay, the reason for all these things will be only because of presence of weak van der Waals forces. And in chemisorption, it takes place at high temperature and require activation energy. That means due to the formation of chemical bonds, to form the chemical bonds, you have to supply more energy, and hence the molecules should be activated, and hence the energy should be applied to give the to form the chemical bonds between the adsorbate and adsorbent. Okay, that is activation energy. It requires high activation energy. And fifth option, multimolecular layer of adsorbate are formed on the surface. Okay, so not a single layer will be formed. The multi-layer of those adsorbate molecules on the adsorbent will be formed. But in case of chemist option, only monomolecular layers are formed because the reaction will take place only once, and hence only one layer will be formed. If adsorption is not specific, that means it is for, you can see the adsorption in all kinds of substances. Okay, and chemisorption is highly specific. That means here, the due to the formation of chemical bonds, only at certain surfaces the chemisorption can be observed. Okay, so these are the certain differences between adsorption and chemisorption as well as their characteristics. Next, what are the factors which affects the adsorption process? Okay, so first one is the nature of adsorbent. Here the same gas may adsorb to different extents on different adsorbent depending upon the nature of adsorbent. And surface area, as surface area of the adsorbent, greater the surface area, the greater is the extent of adsorption. Okay, means as surface area increases, okay, whose surface area? The adsorbent surface area as well as adsorbate molecules surface area. If they increases, then the extent of adsorption will be greater. Simply remember, greater the surface area of the adsorbent, greater will be the extent of adsorption. The nature of gas. Next one is nature of gas being adsorbed. Okay, so greater is the critical temperature of gas, greater are the van der Waals forces of attraction, and thus greater is adsorption. Means the gases which are having higher critical temperatures are shows great adsorption power, and the gases which shows lower critical temperature, they were having weak van der Waals forces, and hence the adsorption is lesser. Okay, so greater the critical temperature, greater the van der Waals forces, and thus greater is the adsorption. Okay, next one is temperature. The adsorption is an exothermic process involving the equilibrium gas plus adsorbate plus solid adsorbent. If adsorbate are gas molecules and adsorbent is solid, then gas adsorbed on solid plus heat energy is released. As I have already told you, adsorption is an exothermic process. So this is the equilibrium condition. Now applying Le Chatelier's principle, increase of temperature decreases the adsorption. Okay, means as we increase the temperature, in order to maintain the equilibrium, the decrease in the rate of adsorption will be observed. Okay, and if temperature is decreased, greater will be the adsorption process. And pressure, as pressure increases, adsorption will also increases. Okay, at a constant temperature, if you increase the pressure, then adsorption will also increases. And activation of a solid adsorbent, activation means increasing the adsorbing power of solid adsorbent. This can be done by powdering the adsorbate molecules as well as adsorbent molecules in order to increase the surface area. Okay, so these are the factors which affects the adsorption process. Next, adsorption isotherms. Okay, first one is Freundlich adsorption isotherm, which is given by x by m is equal to K into P raised to 1 divided by N, where N is greater than 1. Or this can be also represented as log X by M is equal to log K plus 1 divided by N log P. Okay, remember this equation, one of the important equation. So where X is mass of the gas adsorbed, M is mass of absorbent, and P is pressure, K and N are constants. Okay, and these are the graphs, and this shows that with increase in pressure, the extent of adsorption, this X by M ratio will indicates the rate of adsorption or extent of adsorption. So as the pressure increases, the rate of adsorption will also increases. But if you observe this graph, at a higher pressure, the adsorption process will remain constant. Okay, no increase in the adsorption process will observed at high pressure. Okay, to overcome this, another scientist has given the isotherm, that is known as Langmuir isotherm or Langmuir isotherm, and this is given as theta is equal to Kp divided by 1 plus Kp. Just remember this equation. Okay, so one of the important equation, that is theta is equal to Kp divided by 1 plus Kp, Langmuir equation. Okay, and here I have already given theta means fraction of the surface of adsorbent available for adsorption, P is pressure, and K are constants for adsorption. Okay, and this is the graph which represents the Langmuir adsorption isotherm. The next concept in the surface area will be catalysis. Catalysis is the process where we can increase or decrease the rate of the reaction. And to increase that rate of reaction, or to decrease, or we can say to alter the rate of reaction, we will add certain chemical substances. Those chemical substances which are added to increase or to change the rate of reaction without being used up in that reaction are known as catalysts. And this process is known as catalysis process. Okay, and these are certain processes, and here the catalyst name are given. Okay, for following processes, remember these processes names and the catalyst which are used in those processes. Okay, next, the catalyst may be positive or negative. So positive catalyst means it increases rate of reaction, and negative catalyst means decreases rate of reaction. And there are two types of catalysis: homogeneous catalysis and heterogeneous catalysis. So first we will see what is homogeneous catalysis. Homogeneous catalysis means here the catalyst and reactant are in the same physical state. Okay, or in same phase. Means if you see the example here, what you will see, SO2 is present in gaseous form, O2 is also present in gaseous form. These are the reactant molecules. And now here NO, that is nitrous oxide, this is also present in gaseous form. That means the reactants as well as the catalyst are present in same phase, and hence it is a homogeneous catalysis. Then heterogeneous catalysis. In heterogeneous catalysis, the catalyst is present in different phase than that of the reactants. For example, if you say the potassium chlorate, here the potassium chlorate is in solid state, but MnO2 is present in gaseous state. That gives KCl and oxygen. So here the solid and gas, so there are two different states are present, and hence it is known as heterogeneous catalysis process. If there is a same phase, then it is known as homogeneous catalysis. If there is a heterogeneous catalysis, that means there are two different phases are present. Then another one is autocatalysis. Autocatalysis means one of the product of the reaction will act as a catalyst. So during the reaction, the product formed will itself act as a catalyst in order to carry out reaction. Such type of processes are said to be autocatalysis processes. So these are certain types of catalysis. Then what are the characteristics of a catalyst? So just to go through these characteristics, means its mass and chemical composition remains unchanged, and for reversible, does catalyst does not influence the composition of reaction mixture at equilibrium. Okay, then the another two important terms are promoters and poisons. So what are promoters and poisons, that we have to see. So promoters, these are the chemical substances that enhances the chemical activity of catalyst, while poisons decreases the activity of the catalyst. So promoters, they promotes or increases activity of catalyst. Poisons decreases the activity of catalyst. The next is adsorption theory of heterogeneous catalysis. So how the adsorption takes place and how it helps to explain the catalyzed activity. So as you know, with upon addition of catalyst, the rate of reaction will increases. What is the reason for that? That can be explained with the help of adsorption. So this is the catalyst. The first step is diffusion of reactants to the surface of the catalyst. So these are the reactants. So these two will diffuses to the surface of the catalyst. Okay, then they will form the weak van der Waals force or chemical bond, and the intermediate will be formed, means when A and B comes near to each other, then there will be formation of intermediate, and then they will react with each other and forms the product. Okay, and hence the catalyst will remain as it is. So chemical reaction will occur here, and then desorption of that product is takes place. So this is how we can explain the adsorption theory for heterogeneous catalysis. The next concept is important features of solid catalyst. So what are the features of a catalyst? One of the feature is activity. Activity means it is the strength of chemisorption to a large extent. It depends upon the strength of chemisorption to a large extent. That means it will increases the activity of the catalyst, that it has that power to activate the rate of reaction. And selectivity. The selectivity of the catalyst is its ability to direct a reaction to yield a particular product. So here you can see the example. From one of the example, here the reactants are same, but the catalyst are different. If our first reaction nickel is there, for second copper, zinc oxide and chromium oxide are there, and in third copper will act as a catalyst. But the reactants are same for all these reactions, and hence based upon the catalyst we will get the different products, and this is due to the ability of catalyst to direct the rate of reaction, Then shape selective catalysis. The catalytic reaction that depends upon the pore structure of the catalyst and size of the reactant and product molecules is called shape selective catalysis. ZSM5 is one of the example, and it converts alcohols directly into gasoline. Okay, then the next one is enzyme catalysis. Enzyme catalysis are also known as enzymes. These are also known as biochemical catalysts, and that process is also known as biochemical catalysis. So mechanism will take place in two steps. This can be explained with the help of lock and key model. So initially, in step one, what happens? Enzyme will attack to the substrate molecule. Here enzyme will act as the catalyst, and the substrate is any reactant. So enzyme plus substrate combined to form enzyme substrate complex. Okay, and then The breaking of that molecule will take place in order to form the products, and the enzyme will remain as it is. This is how we can explain the enzyme catalysis. Okay, enzymes, these are all acts as a catalyst and helps in metabolism. Next, some of the examples of enzyme catalyzed reactions are given here. Okay, simply go through these things. Important also, okay, invertase, what it does, diastase, maltose, urease, okay, all these are enzymes and they will catalyze the particular reaction. Then characteristics of enzyme catalysis: they are high efficient, highly specific nature, optimum temperature. The optimum temperature means the temperature at which the enzyme have high activity, means higher yield, they will give higher yield. And for human being, the 310 Kelvin is considered as the optimum temperature. And optimum pH means the pH at which the enzyme catalysis activity is more or maximum, and the pH range is 5 to 7, optimum pH in human beings. Activators are helps to increase the activation of enzymes. Coenzymes, these coenzymes, substances having the nature similar to the enzyme, and their presence increases the enzyme activity. And most vitamins will act as coenzymes. And effect of inhibitors: inhibitors slow down the rate of an enzymatic reaction. Inhibitors, you know, inhibitors means the substances which stops the reaction. So here also, inhibitors will slow down the enzymatic reactions. These are some characteristics of enzyme catalysis. Next concept is colloids. Colloids, these are the substances or the solutions which are having, first of all, these are heterogeneous mixtures where the particle size ranges from 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer. Below 1 nanometer, they are said to be true solutions. Above 100 nanometer, they are said to be suspensions. The colloids have two phases, dispersed phase and dispersion medium. So dispersed phase is which is dispersed or scattered through the dispersion medium. So dispersed phase is present in smaller quantity, dispersion medium is present in larger quantity. Simply you can say it acts as a solvent and this one will act as a solute. And this table is very important. Okay, this table represents if the dispersed phase is in solid state and dispersion medium is in liquid state, then which type of colloid is formed. Here they have given the sole will be formed, and the examples are also given: gold sole, mud, ferric hydroxide sole, etc. So go through this table. Each and every type of the colloid is important. These are the 8 types of colloids which are classified on the basis of physical states of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. Remember, what is the dispersed phase for these colloids? Okay, all these 8 colloids. And what is dispersion medium for these colloids? And examples also. So just remember this table, very important for exam point of view. Okay, next, lyophobic and lyophilic colloids. Lyophobic means these are solvent hating salts, and lyophilic colloids means solvent loving salts. These are another type of colloids where which can be classified on the basis of attractive power between the solvent and solute. Okay, then emulsions. Emulsions of oil in water and emulsions of water in oil, these are the two types of emulsions. Examples for emulsions in oil in water are milk and vanishing cream. Okay, and emulsions of water in oil, the examples are butter, ice cream, etc. Okay, this is about emulsions. Then difference between true solutions, suspension and colloids is given. So here, as you already know this, True solution is a homogeneous mixture and suspension is a heterogeneous mixture. Colloidal solution is also heterogeneous mixture. This is the particle size of true solution 1 nanometer. Particle size in suspension is 1000 nanometer and for colloids it is 1 to 1000 nanometer. Then don't settle down. Settle down under the influence of gravity, colloids will also don't settle down. One of the main important is the true solution does not show Tyndall effect. Suspensions show Tyndall effect and colloids will also show Tyndall effect. Then methods of preparation of colloids. There are chemical methods as well as physical methods. Chemical methods can be carried out by double decomposition, oxidation and reduction and hydrolysis. So these are the four ways or four types of reactions which by using those reactions we can prepare the colloidal solutions. And Bredig's arc method. This is one of the physical method which is used to prepare the gold sole, especially metal soles, and by using this we can prepare gold sole, platinum sole, silver sole. All the type of metal soles can be prepared from Bredig's arc method. Okay. Then peptization. Peptization means the process of converting a precipitate into colloidal sole by shaking it with electrolyte in dispersion medium. So precipitate is gets converted into colloidal solution by peptide. This process is known as peptization. Then Hardy-Schultz rule. Hardy-Schultz rule, it gives relationship between the coagulating power or colloidal particle has to capacity of colloidal particle coagulate to collide. So ion carrying charge opposite to the colloidal particle has capacity to coagulate the collide. Greater the valency of ion, greater will be the coagulating power. This is the statement of Hardy-Schultz rule. Just remember that. Okay. And here you can see another term, that is gold number. The minimum amount of lyophilic collide in milligrams which can prevent the coagulation of 10 ml gold sole against 1 ml of 10% NaCl solution is said to be gold number, and this is used in protective collides. For protection of collides we will use lyophilic collides. Lyophilic collides acts as protective collides, and there we will define the amount of lyophilic collide required in milligrams to prevent the coagulation is expressed in terms of gold number. Then surfactants. The surfactants, these are the substances which gets preferentially adsorbed at the air, water and solid water interfaces, forming an oriented monolayer where the hydrophilic groups point towards aqueous phase and the hydrocarbon chain point towards the air or towards the oil phase. There are two types of surfactants: anionic surfactants, cationic surfactants, as well as another one is non-ionogenic surfactants. So remember these three types of surfactants and examples for those surfactants. And another one is micellae. This is also very important. Micellae is aggregates formed when the surfactant molecules in the water-air interface become so packed in the monolayer that no more molecules can be accumulated with ease. They accumulate in the bulk of the solution. So this micellae, these consist of the two parts. One is hydrocarbon part, that is hydrophilic, and another one is hydrophobic. So this one is hydrophobic, the tail part is hydrophobic and head part is hydrophilic. So it moves towards water and it moves towards the another non-polar solvent. Now these are certain concepts that we have learnt in surface chemistry. Just go through all these theory part, okay, then try to solve the MCQs on surface chemistry. Next, we will move to the MCQs based on this chapter. So the first one, adsorbed acetic acid on activated charcoal is. So if the activated charcoal is adsorbent, then the acetic acid which is adsorbed on the surface of that adsorbent is known as adsorbate. Okay, so in theory only you have learned that adsorbate, adsorbent and interface. Okay, so the option D is the right one. Adsorbed acetic acid on activated charcoal acts as adsorbate. Okay, then second one, adsorption is always, the heat energy is released during the adsorption process. So the option B is the right one. That means exothermic, because heat is released during the process of adsorption. That is, delta H is less than zero or negative. That itself indicates the heat is released. And if the heat is released during the process, such type of process is said to be exothermic. And adsorption is exothermic process. Third one, which is not correct regarding the physical adsorption of a gas on surface of solid. So the option A, on increasing the temperature, the adsorption increases continuously. Is it a correct? As you know, according to Lee Chatelier's principle, here the adsorption is exothermic. So on increasing the temperature, in order to reduce the temperature or heat energy at right hand side, the rate of reaction takes backwards and hence the adsorption decreases. So option A itself is the wrong statement, and for this question the correct answer is option A. And what are the other options? Enthalpy and entropy changes are negative, so this is right. Adsorption is more for some specific substances, this one is also right. And adsorption is reversible. Okay, physical adsorption is reversible also. So this is the option A, this one is the right. On increasing temperature, the adsorption decreases. The fourth one, adsorption is accompanied by, means what are the conditions when the adsorption takes place? Option A, decrease in enthalpy and increase in entropy. This is wrong. Increase in enthalpy and increase in entropy. This one is also wrong. Decrease in enthalpy and decrease in entropy. So this is the right one, because delta H is less than zero and delta S is also less than zero. So the change in enthalpy and change in entropy, okay, will always decreases. So option C is the right one. Fifth one, the extent of physisorption of a gas increases with decrease in temperature. So option B, as temperature decreases, the physisorption of gas increases. If temperature increases, physisorption decreases. If surface area decreases, then also physisorption decreases. Surface area increases, the adsorption process increases. Okay, decrease in strength of van der Waals force, then also physisorption decreases. So the correct option is option B. Decreases in temperature increases the extent of physisorption. For adsorption of a gas on a solid, the plot of log x by m versus log p is linear with slope equal to, okay, that slope which you will obtain during the plot of, when you plot the graph of, as you, this is from Prenlich adsorption isotherm. So when you plot the graph, this is the slope, okay, and this is the intercept. And what is the equation? This is the graph for Prenlich adsorption isotherm. This is log k, okay, this is the slope, that is 1 by n. And here what they asked, the linear with the slope equal to, where n being the whole number. So the option D, the slope will be 1 divided by n. So here 1 by divide sign is erased. So answer is 1 divided by n. So option D is the right one. Then seventh one, according to Freundlich adsorption isotherm, the amount of gas adsorbed at a very high pressure reaches a constant limiting value, goes on increasing with pressure, goes on decreasing with pressure, increases first and decreases later with pressure. So if you observe the Freundlich adsorption isotherm, how it looks, graph of Freundlich adsorption isotherm, this can be represented like this. You can represent the graph like this. So initially increases, and at higher pressure adsorption process remains constant. At this stage it go on remains constant. So if you further extend this graph, you will get the graph like this, which gives the linear. So reaches a constant limiting value at high pressure. Okay, so option A is the right one.
Action. No, decrease the rate of backward reaction, that is also wrong. What it actually makes means, it allow the equilibrium to be achieved quickly. Means if we take two reactants A and B, okay, and forms the product C, then in order to attain equilibrium, initially the reaction takes place slowly, but when we add the catalyst, in order to maintain equilibrium, means the rate of forward reaction must be equal to rate of backward reaction. For that reason, it has to achieve the equilibrium, and that equilibrium will be achieved quickly upon addition of catalyst. So among these options, the option D is the right one. That is, the catalyst will allow the equilibrium to be achieved quickly. So the next one, ninth one, a catalyst lowers the activation energy, changes the rate constant, changes the product itself destroyed in the reaction. So as you know, catalyst will alters the rate of reaction or increases the rate of reaction. So how it increases the rate of reaction? If we consider this one as a graph, and here I have taken A and it gets converted into a product B, and the graph can be represented like this. Okay, now this is a product B. Now the energy which is required to activate this is said to be activation energy, that is EA. It is represented as EA. Okay, now it is a reaction where we have not used catalyst. This is the activation energy. Now if I want to increase the rate of reaction, what I need to do? I have to decrease this activation energy. So catalyst will also does the same thing. If we add the catalyst, then the reaction path will be represented like this. Okay, that means it will decreases the activation energy. Okay, so by decreasing or by lowering the activation energy, the rate of reaction can be increased, and the same thing will be done by catalyst. So among these four options, option A is the right one. It lowers the activation energy. Tenth one, which of the following kind of catalysis can be explained by the adsorption theory? So if you go through the synopsis, you come to know that based on adsorption theory, we can able to explain the heterogeneous catalysis. Okay, because adsorption, it takes place when there are two different mediums are there, and in heterogeneous catalysis, the two different phases will be present, and hence heterogeneous catalysis can be explained on the basis of adsorption theory. So option C is the right answer. Next, 11th one, the activation action of enzymes in living system is to supply energy to tissues, enhance immunity, circulate oxygen, enhance the rate of biochemical reactions. As you already know, enzymes, they are also known as biochemical catalysts. That means, catalyst means they will enhance the rate of reaction or increases the rate of reaction. And enzymes will also do the same thing, but since they are present in the body and since they are enhancing the rate of reaction in living system, so those reactions are said to be biochemical reactions, because those chemical reactions are taking place in living system, and hence the enzymes will enhance the rate of biochemical reactions, and hence the option D is the right one. 12th one, milk is a colloid in which you have to remember which one is dispersed phase and which one is dispersion medium. Dispersed phase means it is present in small quantity. Dispersion medium means it is present in large quantity. So first of all, milk, it is a type of colloid, and among colloids we have classified based upon the physical states of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. Colloids are classified into 8 types: sol, solid sol, solid aerosol, okay, then liquid aerosol. All those things are classified. Now you must know, milk is an example of which kind of colloid among those 8? Milk is an emulsion, okay. So milk is example of an emulsion, and hence we must know what is emulsion. What does emulsion means? Emulsion is colloid where both the liquid and both the dispersed phase and dispersion medium are in liquid state. So emulsion, liquid is dispersed in liquid medium, that is dispersion medium. So the option A, because in emulsion both the dispersed phase and dispersion medium are in liquid state, hence milk is an example of emulsion. So option A, liquid is dispersed in a liquid. So option A is the right one. 13th one, an aerosol is a, on the basis of physical states of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. So aerosol means when the solid is dispersed in a gas, then it is said to be aerosol. If liquid is dispersed in a gas, then it is said to be liquid aerosol. But here they have simply mentioned aerosol, so it is nothing but the solid dispersed in gas. So which option is right? Option A, dispersion of a solid or liquid in a gas, dispersion of a solid in a liquid, dispersion of a liquid in a solid, in a liquid and solid solution. So the option A, here they have mentioned both solid and liquid. So you can say dispersion of a solid or liquid in a gas. It is the right one, option A. 14th, if dispersed phase is a liquid and dispersion medium is the solid, the colloid is known as, so dispersed phase is liquid, dispersion medium is solid, okay. Dispersion medium means in a large quantity solid is there and in small quantity liquid is there. Liquid is dispersed in solid, and hence when this kind of combination is present, then the resulting colloid will be a gel. So option B is the right one. Aerosol means It is where the dispersed phase and dispersion medium are liquid and solid. Sol means solid is dispersed in liquid. Gel means liquid is dispersed in solid. Emulsion means liquid is dispersed in liquid. Option D, foam. Foam means gas is dispersed in liquid. Then it will form a foam. So the option B, in these options, option B is the right one. 15th one, at the critical missile concentration, the surfactant molecules will starts to associate and forms the micelles. So the option, which one is right? A, decomposes, no. Dissociates, no. Option C, associates, okay. And option D becomes completely soluble. So among these, option C is the right one. It is a simple theory question, and you have to, if you go through the synopsis, you will get the answer. So first, you simply read all the synopsis, then try to solve these questions. Okay. 16th, the formation of micelles takes place only above inversion temperature, boil temperature, critical temperature, Kraft temperature. So formation of micelles will take place at certain temperature. Above that temperature only, the formation of micelles can be observed. And that temperature is known as Kraft temperature. So the option D is the right one. 17. A precipitate is changed to colloidal solution by the following process. So dialysis, it is one of the purification method of colloids. Ultrafiltration is also purification method. Electrophoresis, it is the process of coagulation. By using this, we can form a precipitate, electrophoresis. Peptidization, this is the process where we can convert a precipitate into colloidal solution. So peptidization, option C is the right one. Next, 18th, pure water can be obtained from sea water by, so which one is right here? Centrifugation, plasmolysis, sedimentation, reverse osmosis. This question you have already learnt in even in solution. So the option C, reverse osmosis, it is the right one. Next one, 19th, the formation of colloid from suspension is, so how we will form a colloid from precipitate, that is suspension. Previously in 17th question only you have seen, both are same questions, simply they have changed the term precipitate into suspension, and suspension is also nothing but precipitate only. So that process of conversion of precipitate or suspension into colloid is known as peptidization. So option A is the right one. Next, 20th question, the movement of colloidal particles towards their respective electrodes in the presence of an electric field is known as. So when we consider the colloidal solution, upon subjecting that into electric field, the particles, since the colloids are charged particles, they may have positive or negative charge. When they are subjected to electric fields, the positively charged particles will move to the cathode and negatively charged particles will move to anode. So that process is known as electrophoresis. Okay, electrophoresis. And Brownian movement, it is nothing but the zigzag movement of colloidal particles. Electrodialysis, it is one of the purification method. Electrolysis, it is conversion of electrical energy into chemical energy. So the option D is the right one, electrophoresis. Okay. 21st, Hardy-Schulz rule explains the effect of electrolytes on the coagulation of colloidal solution. According to this rule, coagulation power of cations follow the order. What does Hardy-Scholes rule explains? It states higher the valency, greater will be the coagulating power. So the colloidal particles having high valency will have higher coagulating power. Among these, which one is having best coagulation power or high coagulation power? So see here, which one is first? You have to take the highest, then you have to take the lowest coagulating power ion. So this one, option A, C, Ba plus 2, Na plus, Al plus 3. So Ba plus 2 is greater than Na plus, Na plus is greater than Al plus 3. This one is wrong, because higher valency ions will have greater coagulation power. So option B, Al plus 3, Na plus, Ba plus 2, this one is also wrong. Al plus 3, it is having high coagulation power, but next to that Ba plus 2 should come, then Na plus, because Ba plus 2, after plus 3, plus 2 is having greater value, then plus 1 will having greater value. So option B is also wrong. C, Al plus 3, Ba plus 2, Na plus. So higher, this one is having higher coagulation power, then next one is Ba plus 2, then Na plus. So this one is the correct ordered arrangement of ions having high coagulation power. So the option C is the right one. Remember Hardy-Scholes rule, it states that greater the valency, greater will be the coagulating power. Okay. 22nd, the random motion of colloidal particles is known as. So zigzag motion or random motion of colloidal particles is known as Brownian motion or Brownian moment. One of the important concept. Okay, that is Brownian moment. Option B is the right one. So 23rd, which of the following method is used for coagulation of the soul? For coagulating the colloidal solution, that is how to convert a colloid into precipitate, that can be done by mixing two oppositely charged salts. This one is right. Okay, it is one method to form coagulation or precipitate. And by electrophoresis, this is also right. By addition of electrolytes, this one is also right. These are the different methods from which we can convert colloidal solution into precipitate, that is known as coagulation. If we convert a precipitate into colloidal solution, then it is known as peptization. So here for this question, the answer is all the above, that is option D is the right one. 24th, in petrochemical industry, alcohols are directly converted to gasoline by passing over heated ZSM5. Because in a catalysis, you have learnt the shape selective catalysis. Certain catalysts or catalytic reactions are dependent on pore structure of catalyst as well as reactants. Okay, such type of catalysis process are said to be shape selective catalysis. One of the examples are zeolites, and one of the type of zeolite is ZSM5. It is used to convert alcohols into gasoline. So option B is right one. 25th, in Brownian moment, the paths of the particles are, as I already mentioned, it is random or zigzag. Okay, that zigzag movement of particles is said to be Brownian movement. So option B is the right one. 26th, how does a delta form at the meeting place of sea and river water. Option A. The electrolyte present in seawater coagulate the clay. The electrolyte present in seawater has no role. The electrolyte present in river water coagulate the clay. So here, as you know, where the river water and seawater meets, there the seawater, it has certain coagulating ions, okay? So they have certain charges, and the river water is also having certain electrolytes. When both will come in contact with each other, so sea will also coagulate the clay and river water will also coagulate the clay, and hence option D is the right one. Both A and B are correct. 27th, which of this statement is or are correct? Zeolites are good shape catalysts because of their honeycomb like structures. So this is right one. All zeolites are naturally occurring substances. So this is wrong. Some are artificially prepared also. An important zeolite catalyst used in petroleum industry is ZSM5. This is right. So among these, which one is right? One and third statements are correct one. So option C, first and third, these are the correct statements. 28th, which of the following is not a property of colloidal solution? So it is a heterogeneous mixture, so it is the right one, right? Particle size is greater than 100 nanometer. No, this is wrong one, because the particle size is in between 1 to 100 nanometer. If it exceeds 100 nanometer, then it is said to be suspension. If it is less than 1 nanometer, then it is a true solution. So this is the incorrect property. It shows Tyndall effect, and Brownian moment is also observed in colloidal solution. So the incorrect statement is option B, particle size is greater than 100 nanometer. This is the right one. 29th, colloidal gold is prepared by, so gold sole, we will say it as gold sole, and most of the metal soles, it may be platinum sole, gold sole, copper sole, all kinds of soles are prepared by one of the physical method, that is Bredig's arc method. So by using Bredig's arc method, we can able to prepare the gold sole. Okay, so option C is the right one. 30. How non-polar and polar part in missile are arranged? So if you consider this one as a missile, the head is hydrophilic. Okay, means it is attractive towards water. Which one? The head part. And this is attractive, this tail part is attractive towards the hydrocarbon part. Which one is the option, which option is right? Polar at outer surface and non-polar at inner surface. Polar at inner surface and non-polar at outer surface. Both polar and non-polar at inner surface, distributed all over the surface. So here, if we consider this one as a particle or a oil droplet, then the tail part, it will move towards inner surface, and head part will move outer towards water. So here the non-polar part, this tail is non-polar part and it is move at inner surface, and polar part, that is head part, hydrophilic, it will move at the outer surface. So polar at outer surface and non-polar at inner surface. Option A is the right one. So these are all some questions. which can be asked from the chapter Surface Chemistry. Go through all the theory part and synopsis and try to solve the problems more and more. So these are some important questions that I have covered from the Surface Chemistry.